Jasper Carrott. There's only one Jasper Carrott. One Jasper Carrott. There's only one Jasper Carrott.
One Jasper Carrott.
Thank you. Good evening and welcome to the Theatre Royal Drury Lane on our very special night. We have the Prince and Princess of Wales with us tonight. Good evening, sir. Good evening, madam. It's in a bit of a mess, royalty, isn't it? What worries me, see, if anything happened to Charles, God forbid, whoever she marries will be king. Could be me. King Carrot. Hey, I wouldn't be paying tax. I'd employ Ken Dodd's accountant, me. So, here we are. They've all been on here, you know. Gielgud, Laurence Olivier, the Crankies. Isn't it strange? It's the West End, and there's not one pantomime in the West End this year. Don't you think that's remarkable? The reason kids hate pantomimes, you know? Kids hate pantomimes. It's us, adults. We keep pantomimes going. It's us going, he's behind you! Oh, yes, he is! Oh, no, he isn't! There's your kid going, shut up, Dad. Yeah, it's me dad. I've been touring around this year, and like it, the thing is, everybody's employing all these Australian soap stars to headline these pantomimes. I mean, it's a bit of a risky business, isn't it? They've given one of them a speaking line. Skippy. Jason Donovan was going to do pantomime, but thought better of it. Well, you can't have the old audience shouting it. Oh, yes, he is! Oh, no, he is! He's behind you. No, never mind. Now, behave yourselves. Behave yourselves. I can't believe it's Christmas. I really can't. It's like, we've got to go through the present ritual again. So, have you got an auntie who still thinks you're 9 years old? I'll be there in the booze at Christmas Day lunchtime in my noddy slippers and my Zotto cape. You know? It's like presents, it's just a... Have you... The difference between men and women with presents. I mean, women get presents, it's all, oh, yes, oh, that's just what I wanted. And yes, well, I knew I was walking around everyone. I thought, that's just, oh, you are... Men, it's like, oh, I bought you something. Oh, thanks very much. Thanks. For, it's just what I wanted. Oh, good. Oh, I don't know what it is. Neither do I, but I bought you something. Oh, thanks. Like the three wise men, you know, I bought this for Jesus. It's only a bit of gold or something. I don't know. I got it from Ratner's or something like that. Last year, do you know, last year, I must have had 3 gallon of smellies. Because that's what it's done. I mean, people don't, I didn't know what to buy you. Bought you some smellies. You won't like it. The bloody hell did you buy it me for then, you know? It's like, I mean, manufacturers aren't daft. There must be now a smelly for every part of your body. Well, almost every part, all right. I'm waiting for Peony Fresh to come out, then I've got the luck. With a bit of luck, it'll be a roll-on. And all men's smellies, they've all got macho names, haven't they? Brute and Hero and Thrust and Ram. It's never Librarian, is it? I mean, this is a strange spot for women. Why do these bits have to smell nice? What are they, erogenous zones or something? You're getting ready at night, you look like bloody grasshoppers. I tell you what will be a big seller this year. This will be in a lot of wives' Christmas stockings. That new sex instructional video. Yes, you know what one I mean, don't you? I mean, the thing is, it's like, because it, I mean, it's hard porn, isn't it? And but because it's sex instructional, you know, you can have it next to Nick Faldo. I haven't seen it. I was in it, but I haven't seen it. And there's a beautiful piece of advice for women in the middle. It says, ladies, if you've had a really good, satisfying sexual experience, remember to tell your husband. Who's going to make a phone call that time of night? and they tell you to sort of use anything handy to stimulate your partner. Marmite. Marmite. You spread Marmite over it. It'd be like bonking a twiglet, wouldn't it? Sex instructional video. They'll have a GCSE on it now, won't they? I won't mind the practical. Stuff the oral. It's strange how people go about meeting each other. Do you watch Blind Date? Yeah. It's you, is it? God, there's some ugly people in the world. And they all sit on stools. And then... Thank you. Because you always watch Blind Date when you're getting ready to go out on a Saturday night. And it's always my observation, blokes always seem to pick the woman that you think they're going to pick. They're very predictable men, but women, you haven't got a clue. Yeah, I mean, I haven't got a clue. And until about every 4 or 5 weeks, it's the same scenario, okay? Like there's 3 blokes, and 2 of them are pretty good. You know, Chippendales, sort of sperm whales, you know. And the other bloke's like a refried dung beetle, you know. One of them orange cagoules on, you know. I'm a train spotter, you know. And the women always choose the dung beetle. Every single time. It must be the mothering instinct or something. And you're hopeless at hiding your disappointment. You don't even give it a try on Blind Date, do you? They're still going, well, Mary, you turned down Malcolm. Oh, Malcolm, oh my God. Oh, I'm going to change my mind, give me Malcolm. Yeah. And you turned down Brian. Oh, Brian's better than Malcolm, I'll have them both 3 in the bed, silly. Yeah, 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 yeah. But you chose Eric. Shit. Stupid pro. It's all about that, isn't it? The whole Why don't they just drill a hole in the partition and let them get on? And they never get it over. They never do it, do they? When all them conversations, oh, no, nobody ever does. I reckon the Goldblend couple met on blind date. 4 years he's been trying to get his leg over. Maybe he ought to chase his brand of coffee. He might have a chance, mightn't he? It's not exactly a subtle advert, is it? I mean, she hasn't been subtle right from the first, has she? Ring. Oh, hi. I've just moved in next door. And I've run out of coffee. God, and we buy the damn stuff. I can't believe it. And it's such a successful advert. I mean, everybody's copying it, don't I? I mean, like Coke in a ring. Oh, hi. I just moved in next door. Do you have any Coke? Yep. It's in the coffee jar. I'm waiting for the new Andrex ad to come out now. Oh, hi! I've just moved in next door and I've run out of... It's too late. I suppose a shag's out the question. So, what's been going on? There's a boar season. There's a boar season going on. Yeah, I'll talk you through it. There's astrological boars. Everyone's into horoscopes now. You can't walk out your front door unless Russell Grant says it's all right. You know? And all that New Age and Age of Aquarius and Doris Stokes, all that business, you know. I don't know what you make of it. I mean, I met Doris Stokes when she was on this side. And, oh, lovely old girl. What a scam she had going. I mean, you've got to admire her. What, she used to fill the Albert Hall for the week, 6,500 people a night. And she'd come out and go, is there anybody here called John? Yes, my name's John. How does she do it? I don't know. It's a miracle. It's unbelievable. Everyone's into horoscopes. You must have been at parties. Is that a right pain? Hello? What sign are you? Humpback bridge. Slippery when wet. That's a good one. Shut some up. I'm lucky because I was born in March. So I can always say Piskies. Oh, no. I think you find that pronounced Pisces. No, it's Piskies. As in off. And then you get dieting boars. See, it's starting to make a bit of sense now. I mean, everyone you meet's on a diet, don't they? I've got to lose some weight for Christmas. I'm only eating lettuce now. They've got the entire bloody crop of Cornwall by the looks of it. It's never their fault, they're fat, is it? Oh, no, I hardly eat. It's me glands, that's why I'm like this. It's me hormones. It's not glands, it's not hormones, it's food. Immense amounts of food. Look, this hole here is bigger than this hole here. Glands, hormones, and... And then you get ski boars. That shut some of you up, hasn't it? You're ski boars. You're going skiing. We're going to hear all about it again. You're still on about last year. Yep. It doesn't ever cross your mind that there are people in this world who couldn't give a toss about skiing. This doesn't cross your mind. Oh, you must go skiing, Jasper. It's absolutely fabulous. I don't want to go. Oh, you must go. It's so exhilarating having that step.
I really don't want. Oh, you must go, mustn't you, Arnold? We didn't want to go. We've been going every year now for 15 years. That place keeps. Look! For all the ski boards here, and I think I speak on behalf of the vast majority of people in this room, we don't want to go skiing. Can you get this through your thick head? We've never been, we never want to go, we never will go. We don't like the cold. We have no sense of balance. We don't want to crack our head open or rock. We don't want to go skiing! Oh, but you must bollocks! We don't want to go skiing! I don't want to come hurtling down a mountain 80 mile an hour with a pair of Esther Ranson toothpicks on my feet. And you make such stupid statements. Well, you see such wonderful things. What? Snow. One woman said, she said, well, I go for the acts of courage. You see such wonderful acts of courage. Yeah, oh, yes. She said, well, last year I saw this gentleman coming down the piste 30, 40 mile an hour, and he was blind. The greatest act of courage I've ever seen. I thought, yeah, what about his Labrador? The one time he don't want to see a tree. Ski boards, yeah. What else? Why, it's been a hell of an 18 months. You all right, eh? I'd take her out, she's almost ready there, you know. Go on, you enjoy it, you know. Cheer up, for Christ's sake, you know. Forgot what I was going to say now. Buddy, you brought a pig with you now. Hang on, I'm going to have to change tape now. We are. Yeah. I was at, in July. This is interesting. It was in the news on Friday. I did Long Larton Top Security Prison in Worcestershire. Sounded like a good idea at the time. And I got there. You just do not realise what prisons are about. I mean, you know, they say prisons are like holiday camps. Well, I've worked at Butlins. I never saw anybody carrying a bucket of crap around with them. I mean, you go through three levels of security. It's incredibly intimidating. And I got into the centre compound, and the governor runs up and he goes, "They're all in tonight." He said, "The Palestinian guerrillas, the Iraqis, the long-termers, the murderers, the Glaswegians." The Glaswegians? Bloody right, there's a couple of dozen of them. They rule the prison, you know. And they insisted on playing snooker with me before the show. It took me hours to get the chalk off my head. And like I'm sitting there, you know, like, and they're all sort of staring at me, and it's difficult to understand Glaswegians when they're next to you, but when they're 40 or 50 foot away, you've got no chance, have you? "Hey, you carrot, you get your head in the smack and around up until you hear, eh?" And I've got the guitar, you know, and they give you a list of songs you can't sing, like "Please Release Me," and "There's a Hole in My Bucket," "Up on the Roof," all that. Aye. And then I've been touring with a guy called Phil Cool, who you may know. And we're in a seaside town, again in July. And we did hospital radio. And I don't know if you know much about hospital radio, but it's all volunteers and stuff, and it's all very enthusiastic. And most DJs start off in hospital radio as anaesthetists. AMFM. I mean, AM stands for absolute moron. I can't tell you what it is. Bloody, you're doing the jokes yourself now, aren't you? And we're doing this hospital radio. And there's a young DJ, he's only about 16 or 17. And he's like a bag of jelly. And we're trying to put him at his ease, you know. And we're doing this conversation live to air. And every so often he'd go and he'd play a record for somebody at the hospital.
So we're chatting away and he breaks off and he plays this record for this woman who's having an operation in the afternoon. So he puts the record on and while he's playing, we're chatting off air. And then I realise that he's playing the Bee Gees' Staying Alive. I thought, well, I better tell him he could get into trouble. So I told him, he just threw a wobbly. He grabbed the first record he could find and slapped it on. It was Bob Dylan's Knocking on Heaven's Door. Tell you don't have to write it, you see. You don't have to write it. Just happens. Just observe what happens to you. And just before last Christmas, there you go, at home, we acquired a cat. Yeah, nothing spectacular about that. Unless you know the Carrott household and our history of pets. Because we seem to clock for doolally pets, you know. All toucans short of a six-pack, all that sort of thing. I do routines on them, so it's not so bad. And, Oh, we used to have a Labrador called Biffer, who had the intelligence of a daffodil. A lovely dog, but totally stupid, you know. Chase parked cars and all that. Oh, he walked backwards wagging his head. Stupid dog, stupid. And we're having a bit of trouble with vermin, you know, rats and mice and stuff. And we weren't too sure what to do, so we had a little family confab, as we do on these occasions. And we didn't want to put poison down, you know, because of the environment. So we thought we'll take a chance and we'll buy a cat and this will be nature's way of looking after the problem. So I was elected to go and buy a cat. Not that I know much about them, but I know more than the rest of the family. And cut a long story short, I bought this cat off a bent pet salesman. That's what he did for a living. He sold bent pets. Tortoises with wheels on and all that. And a mate of mine bought an Alsatian off him with a hair lip, you know. Yes, I know it's sick, but it's funny, isn't it? I mean, it's we used to go round to his house and purposely goad the dog so it would bark and no, no. It was a brilliant guard dog, and no, and that burglar just fall over laughing. Anyway, this bloke sold me this cat, and he said it was a Manx cat. But a very rare Manx cat. It had got a tail. Yes, I know now, yes. So I said, well, is it a good ratter? He said, oh, it's a brilliant ratter. Yeah. Fabulous ratter. One of the best we've had here, brilliant. Oh, well, can I see him? He said, oh, yeah, yeah, hang on, so I'll go and get him. So he went out in the back and it was a bit of a kerfuffle. And he comes back with this cat. Without a word of a lie, this cat was on a 3-foot stiff brass rod lead. Because this cat was... Bloody hell! They've got a metal cage round its head. Like something from Silence of the Lambs, you know. I swear blind, at one stage it went... Oh, now that I've got kids. He said, oh, it loves kids. I said, oh, very good. So I'm not having that. He said, it's a brilliant rat. I said, I'm sure it is. I don't know. He says, it's all right. It's all right. He's a bit upset because he doesn't know you. He said, he'll get used to it. He said, look. If you don't like him, you can bring him back. Fabulous ratter. Brilliant. Best one we've had here. I can bring him back. Yeah, yep. Yeah. Fabulous ratter. Bring him back. All right. I'll give him 55 quid. Yes, I know now, yes. Bloody good out there, aren't you? I had to get this cat out. I got it out into the street, people are leaping out, it's like a black panther. And the only way I could get him out is to lift the boot up, pick him up with this rod thing, stick him in and slam the boot. I'm driving home, he's banging his head in the boot. Bang, 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 bang. People are shouting, is something the matter with your car, mate? It's all right, it's the cat. I get this cat home, it's a psychopath. I've bought a psychopath. It does nothing but eat, sleep, kill and bonk. Anything that moves, bang, slap, gobble, it's gone. And what do the kids call this psychopath? Lollipop.
mean, you feel such a prat. It's next door molesting the Rottweiler, you know. Lollipop! Lollipop!
You give him that leg back now, give him that leg back.
It's a bloody menace. I mean, you wake up in the morning, go downstairs, open the back door, there's a dead cow on the step. It gets in the house, it ruins everything. We haven't got a set of curtains there. The only way I can control him is with the vacuum cleaner. He's scared of the vacuum cleaner. We've got this old cylindrical thing, you know? And he comes in the house and I have to plug it in. Beep. I managed to get him into a corner. Then I get that attachment you clean sofas with, that round one with the bristles on, and I can stick it on his head. Suck him up, take him over to the window, stick him out, turn the power off, and he falls down to the ground. Okay. So, I'm having a few problems with him. And to be fair, I'm trying to get rid of the little basket. But it's not easy, is it? Because the kids love him, and he loves the kids. I think he's waiting for him to grow up more to eat. Anyway, I've taken to putting his food in the middle of the road. Well, it's a very busy road, all right? And it's a cut-through for business people, and it's like an abattoir in the morning, and everything gets killed on this road except Lollipop. He plays chicken with the lorries, you know. Everything gets killed, except pigeons. Pigeons survive. Because you can't run over pigeons, can you? Well, you try, but you can't. They're remarkable birds, aren't they? I mean, you see a big fat pigeon in the middle of the road, he's got his back towards you and he's pecking away.
I'll have this water.
And you physically drive over them. You drive over the pigeon and think, I've got a pigeon, I've got a pigeon, I've got a pigeon. You look in the rearview mirror and there we go. Anyway, things came to a head recently. It was a Sunday night, and all the family's in the lounge, and we're watching television. And it's a wildlife programme. It's one of those Wildlife on One, David Attenborough, something like that. And it's all about baboons. And we're really enjoying this, until Lollipop comes stalking into the lounge. Well, I never gave it a thought. Never crossed my mind. He's never seen a baboon, let alone humped one. Television never stood a chance. Straight at him. Smoke everywhere. Out comes the vacuum cleaner. Suck him off. And I have to get the rediffusion man in, don't I? He's not too happy, is he? What the bloody hell's happened to this television? It's been bonked by the cat. Is that a Rottweiler's leg there? Yeah. Enough is enough. So I said to the family, the cat has to go. Oh, there was moan. Oh, we love life. All right, he can stay, hooray. But he lives outside.
He doesn't like the cold. He's scared of the dark.
All right, final offer. He can stay, but he lives in the garage. Huh. And that's where the problem started. Because next day, my missus said to me, if he's going to live in the garage, you're going to have to put a cat flap in the garage door. Yeah, fair enough. I'll go along with that. Got the yellow pages out. Found some carpenters, some tradesmen. They wanted a fortune, to put a cat flap in a garage door. Said to the missus, I'll do it. And she started to cry. Well, with good reason. I think I'm good at do-it-yourself. I am a complete tosser, I have to admit that. Do you remember there was a house boom in the mid-70s? Our house went down in price because of the improvements I had made to it. I put wallpaper up in the lounge with polyfiller. Polycell, polyfiller, I don't know the damn difference, do I? I'd done one wall and I thought it's cost me 45 quid in wallpaper paste there. It looked as if it had been pebble dashed with nutty slack. You could climb up our lounge wall. I did the toilet door in this house. This is one of my classics, this.
We'd had some carpet laid upstairs, and the bloke had fitted the carpet. He said, look, Mr. Carrott, he said, the toilet door's dragging on the old carpet there. Oh, it'll ruin it. You'll need to have it trimmed. He said, I'll do it for you, a couple of quid. A couple of pound? To trim a door? I think I can handle this one. 5 years in woodwork at school and I built a pipe rack. It was a bloody good pipe rack, all right? Had a bit of trouble getting it out the woodwork room. I measured this door. God knows what I did wrong. Well, I know what I did wrong. I cut too much off. The wrong end. Well, it won't scrape on the ceiling, dear. I thought I must have been right in the first place, so I cut the same amount off the other end. I fitted it up. It was like a Western saloon door. We had one of those semis. When you open the front door, the stairs is here, and the toilet door was at the top of the stairs. So people could call to the house, and you could be sitting on the bog and wave to them without pulling your trousers off. I thought this was brilliant. It was brilliant for getting rid of Jehovah's Witnesses. So I set to fit the cat flap to the garage door. And for my birthday, my in-laws had bought me a Black & Decker Workmate. Totally stupid present to buy me. You know, it'd be like buying Stevie Wonder a kaleidoscope in that lid. And then I fitted this Workmate up. Well, all it does is hold wood. My missus can hold the wood. It's not a Workmate. If it stopped the bleeding and bandaged me head or something, it'd be a Workmate. So I set to the garage door and I fitted the cat flap. It wasn't exactly what I envisaged. Technically, it is a cat flap. Well, let's just say you can now drive the car into the garage without opening the door. Oh, okay. So the missus gave me a bit of a wigging about this. She said, my God, look at the mess you've made of that garage door. Oh, why don't you leave things alone, you bozo? I've had to get a carpenter in there. Come and fix that. It's going to cost a fortune. You tell him who did it. I'm not talking to him. It's far too embarrassing. You tell him what happened. You tell him. Yes, all right, yes. Wig, 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 wig. So this carpenter turns up. My cocky little basket. Starts picking flies straight away, you know. Which dickhead did this then, eh? The missus. So he set to repairing the garage door. And he was a typical tradesman. And he was wearing those typical tradesman's trousers, which you may have heard me go on about before. You know, when they bend over, you can see 4 or 5 inches of bum cleavage. So he bent over and he started to crawl through the cat flap, just as Lollipop was returning. Well, you can't blame the cat. It looked just like a baboon. It just the carpenter had kittens. September, October. Did some filming. This was interesting. And I was filming a series called The Detectives with Robert Powell. He used to be Jesus Christ, now I've got him down to my level. Super bloke, Superman. Very, very well experienced actor. And he's an actor, you know, a thespian, one of those. Well, you know, what is my motivation for sticking this ferret down my trousers? Because it's funny, get it down. Oh, God. And he tells wonderful stories about when I was with John Gielgud and Labby and I'm talking about Jim Bowen and people like that. Anyway, it's one day we're filming and I am dressed as a policeman. I've got the full uniform on and the flat cap. And I've been made up so that I don't look like who I am. I've got a moustache on and hair. Thank you. And come the lunch hour, I wanted to go and do some shopping, you know, and I thought, well, I'm not going to get out of all this gear and all the makeup, so I'll just go as I am. And I had a police car, because my own car was back on location. And they said there was an Asda down the road, and it's a dual carriageway. And I'm driving down this dual carriageway looking for the Asda. I'm doing about 21, 22 mile an hour. Can I find this supermarket? I thought, well, 15, 20 minutes. No, I must have missed it. So I turn around to look behind me, and the traffic was 5 miles back. I thought, blimey, there must be a copper about. It's me. I thought, well, how interesting. And I thought, I wonder how slow I can go before anybody tries to overtake me. I got it down to 14 mile an hour. Then I saw this cavalier coming up the outside, you know, 14 and a half mile an hour. It was a rep, you know. Normally, like, they blast your greenhouse to pieces, but like 14 and a half mile. I mean, he hasn't done 14 and a half miles since he came off the production line, you know, like. And he came right up to my side, and he was staring straight ahead. Because you just never look at coppers when you're passing, do you? Your head's in the neck brace. You know, it's like going through customs, it's the same. Really. And he's coming, I thought, well, you cheeky rip. And I let him just indicate, and he was just coming back into the inside lane, and I hit the siren. Beep, 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 beep. You ever seen anybody try to open up a sunroof with his head? I thought, wonderful, what the effect of this uniform. It has an amazing effect, a police uniform on people. I was shopping in Asda and everybody was putting stuff back on the shelves. I came outside and I started to look for ethnic minorities, acting in a strange way, you know, smiling, walking. And the best bit, I was going back down this dual... Will you laugh with everybody else, please? You've moved from down here, haven't you? I was going back down this dual carriageway and got to the traffic lights. I wanted to go straight ahead. And there was just one car on the outside lane, and I pulled up behind him, about 12 cars on the inside lane. I'm waiting to go ahead. The lights change to green, and he decides that that is the time to indicate to everybody that he's going to turn right. Doesn't that brass you off? Haven't you always wanted to get out of your car? Walk up to him and go, listen, donkey breath! Have some consideration for other people on the road! Well, I'm a policeman. I got out of my car. I walked up to it. It was a Ford Capri. Borderline MOT pass in vomit yellow. Sitting in the driver's seat is a troglodyte. A hairless, tattooed primate with a forehead that kept the rain off his feet. On it was tattooed anchovy, because he can't spell anarchy. Normally, if you look at these people, they eat you from the inside. But he was like a lamb. I knocked on the window. He wound it down. Say you're sorry. I'm sorry, good. Say you're very, very, very sorry. Very, very, very sorry. Good, good. Say Birmingham City are the finest football club. And then my moustache dropped off. He got out of his car. And when I woke up, he'd sat me on his car aerial, and we're doing 35 mile an hour down this dual carriageway. Very interesting. Having listened to Simon Bates for 20 years talking out of his backside, he's now talking out of mine. Worried me quite a while. And, because, like, I am one of the world's worriers. I just sit in bed and worry. Not much else to do, so I worry. And I worry about all sorts of things. I worry about French farmers. French farmers worry me. Who the hell do they think they are? They each own an apple tree and a pig. And they're trying to rule Europe. And there's Mitterrand saying, don't commit violence. That's like asking Norman Lamont not to use his access card. And these French farmers, they're going to go on strike. How will we know? How can... I mean, they don't do anything anyway. All they do is walk around Paris spreading pig shit everywhere. And they're going to go on strike. No more French Golden Delicious. No more camembert cheese. Blimey, I'm slitting my wrists already. You ever tried camembert? The only thing that smells worse is the inside of Liz McColgan's Reeboks. No more Beaujolais Nouveau. What are we going to clean the oil off the drive with now? French farmers are the only people that molest sheep and then burn the evidence. Thank you. Wanted to get that off my chest. I worry about moths. Moths worry me. Why is it you never see moths in the daytime? All that light, and you never see a moth. You go to bed at night, you turn on your tiny reading lamp, zonking great moth. I worry about moths. I worry about the money I waste. I still buy separate shampoo and conditioner. I know what you're asking. Why? Wash and go. I washed it and it went. I'm follically challenged. I'm suffering from premature cojaculation. You ever worry about what they're doing with all the lead they used to put in petrol? Tell you what they're doing with some of it. They're spoon feeding it to late night garage attendants. Pump number 7. Do you want any tokens? You have to go to that little hatch, you know, because they have to lock them up inside. I worry about rhinoceroses. Rhinos worry me. Boy, do we give rhinos a hard time. I mean, they say that rhino horn is an aphrodisiac. If it is, why are they an endangered species? And the thing is, it's the people are trying to protect them. Give them a hard time. I mean, like, you know, what they're doing now is they're cutting the horn off so the poachers won't shoot them for the horn. Fair enough, but they don't leave it at that. The old rhino goes out on the town with his mates down to the watering hole, couple of pints. Some Eric Bristow fires a bloody great dart into his neck. He falls over, they run over, they cut his horn off, and just for good measure, they staple an Amstrad satellite dish to his head. To observe him naturally in the wild. How can you look natural looking like a branch of Dixon's? The rhino wakes up, he thinks, my God, what did I have to drink last night? Where's my nose? Oh, I had a bloody nose last night, what's this on my head? And his missus comes trundling through the bush and goes, look at the state of you! Where's your nose gone? Oh, you've swapped it for that thing on your head, haven't you? Is that a love bite on your neck? You've been out banging that Land Rover again, haven't you? I worry about rhinos. I worry about tree surgeons. Tree surgeons worry me. What a pompous title. You're bloody gardeners. What's a plumber, a lavatory nurse? What a diner rod, you Ben gynecologists? I worry about old people. Old people worry. It's all right to be old, they're holding back. It's all right to be old, it's good fun. When you're old, you can wear what the hell you like. Tea-cosies. Loft insulation. Zip-up tartan booty slippers. when you're old, you can hear what you want to hear. You're round, Grandad. Thank you, I'll have a pint. You've got your own shop, Littlewoods. You don't have to queue anymore. You don't have to queue when you're old. You just barge straight to the front. You know, whoa, whoa, whoa. Here, what are you doing? I'm old. Well, can't you queue? No, I might die. And if you get really old and decrepit and lose all your marbles and start dribbling into your wind carness, they make you into a judge. It's all right to be old. I worry about young people. Young people worry. Worry about education. Education is in a state. Why is it in a state? Because they keep messing around with it, that's why. I mean, it used to be simple, the three R's. Reading, writing and arithmetic. That messed us up for a few years, didn't it? But they don't leave it at that. No, no, they do all sorts of strange things. Like, for instance, where my kids go to school, they're trying to eradicate elitism. So, you can't have group one and group two in the class anymore. Because group two will feel inferior to group one. So they call them red group and blue group. And this has solved the problem. Huh! There's the teacher going, right, red group this morning, write me a thesis on Einstein's theory of relativity in correlation to present day advancement in quantum mechanics. And blue group, play with your jelly molds. I was a jelly mould kid, me, I don't mean. God, I went to a rough school. It had its own coroner. I often wonder how we survived youth. You know, we used to have metalwork at school. Metalwork. Okay, I was 4 years in metalwork. My God, did we build some weapons. We had a Scud 30 years before Iraq, I'll tell you that. And the thing is, it has changed now, but in those days, we never had protection, you never had goggles and helmets and visors and gloves. You were perfectly safe because you were wearing the school apron. This would protect you from anything. Shrapnel, thermal lances. I reckon if President Kennedy had been wearing a school apron, he would have been alive today. It's the same in the gymnasium. They used to put mats to break your fall. I've seen thicker slices of ham. I've seen kids die on mats. They had to climb that gym rope. You ever done that? I managed 2 feet once, that was it. And I used to hang there like a bloody great conker. You know? Do you know, this is a fact. They still have the sack race in British schools. They still have the sack race in British schools. It's the year 2000 and we have the sack race in British schools. I mean, there is America wasting their time teaching their 8 and 9 year olds to be gold medal winners at the Olympics. What are we teaching our kids to be? Vegetables. Does it make you proud to be British? That's our Brian there. My kid does the same as me, and I bet you did it as well. Like, he copies my handwriting to get out of NAF sports. Ever used to do that? Yeah, everybody did. I did it once, because I can't get away with anything, right? And I didn't want to do cross-country. Well, not at our school, anyway. Because, like, handcuffed you to your mate and ran you through the marshes chased by bloodhounds, you know. Like, so I stayed up all night, and I copied my dad's handwriting. It took me hours and hours and hours. I gave the teacher a letter the next day. He opened it up, and it went, "Dear Mr. Cartwright, Jasper cannot do cross-country today because he's just had a vasectomy." "Painful, is it, Carrot?" "Yes, sir, I can hardly breathe." The best one was the kid in front of me. "Why can't you go swimming, Bevan?" "Time of the month, sir." But what really worries me is it's the electronic age. I am having a great deal of difficulty coming to terms with this. For instance, Sony Walkmans. Okay? I'm going to start a campaign against Sony Walkmans. My life is a misery. I use the train a lot. I'm sitting there, reading the paper, minding my own business, and some div gets on with one of these things strapped to their head, and they sit opposite me. I don't have to see them, because I can hear... It's no use glaring at them, because they're totally oblivious to you and everybody else in the universe. It's no use shouting at them, because they can't hear a damn word you're on about. And then... And then they start singing along to the music. Mamma mia, mamma mia, let me go. Beelzebub had a devil for a sideboard. If it's not that, it's Tina Turner and what's a glove got to do with it? But you can't complain, because it's the electronic age. It's an electronic age, you can't complain. Oh, can't you now? So I thought, I will join the electronic age. I will join the electronic age. And I bought a cordless telephone. And now, I can't find it. I could find the old one. It was tied to the wall. I bought a speaking alarm clock. It stuttered. Everybody's asking me the same question. Am I going to buy Philips' new compact cassette system or the new Sony mini-disc system? Because whichever one I choose will be obsolete by Easter. You are looking at Betamax, man. I still have the original video camera. It is the size of Bulgaria. I took it on holiday to the Lake District. I had to phone Pickford's to transport it up the M6. At home, I thought I would treat myself to some electronic gates for the drive. 6 months I've had them. I still cannot remember that when I'm driving in, the gates open outwards. The motor is like a stock car. And then I found out the bloke across the way has had a pacemaker fitted. Every time I open the gates, he runs round the block at 90 miles an hour. We'll have all the complaints about that now. So if you mention anything to do with an affliction, like everybody... And when you get it wrong on TV, do you know about it? Oh, do you know? If you do a sketch about dyslexics or something, the letters you get... Door Jasper Carrott. Love us exiliads along, you winker. Yours fully, Faith. Years ago, I used to do something called Carrots Live. Used to go out Saturday night, 11 o'clock. Live to air. And I started one show by going, well, this week we're going to have a go at deaf people. Oh, God. We had thousands of letters. Right? God knows who told them. One question. A lot of people ask me.
Thank you.
Thank you. do you play that guitar ever? And I said, well, you know Bill Wyman's left the Rolling Stones? I had a phone call from Keith Richards this morning. And do you know what he said? Neither do I. The old mate there is Phil Ackley from, remember Denny Lane? Well, he used to press his shirt, so that's and Phil Tree has been in practically every group going, and he's at the moment, he's working with the Roy Wood Band. The two girls, Christine and Pam, thank you, have joined us just particularly for this night, because normally we just work as a five-piece. And we have on drums one of the greatest rock and roll drummers in the world from the Electric Light Orchestra, Mr. Bev Bevan. And if you've got one of the greatest rock drummers, you need one of the greatest lead guitarists in the world. We have that from Black Sabbath, Mr. Tony Iommi.
Yeah.